spiritual food, hallelujah, the word of God, a powerful or rhema word of God, hallelujah, hallelujah, as we call on our Reverend Dr. Theophilus Lembo for the word of God. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
We thank you, Father Almighty, once again for bringing us before the sanctuary to be filled with your words. We thank you, Father Almighty, for your protection over us over the week, for preserving our life to be able to be here this morning again, Father. As we are here, we open our hearts to you, Father Almighty. We beseech you, O Lord, to consecrate your message. I know the tongue that will deliver it, Father Almighty. And we plead with you, Father, to open our hearts. Give us that spirit of understanding that we so much need to be able to get closer to you. At the end of this message, Father, never let our lives be the same again. Let us live in you. Let us be Christ-like in our life. We give you glory and adoration. In Jesus' name, Father, we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Welcome, church. Can I please get hold of your Bible? While we open our Bible to the book of Ephesians. The book of Ephesians, and you turn to chapter 6. I will be reading from verses 10 to 20. Ephesians chapter 6, and I will be reading from verses 10 to 20. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the full armor of God so that you will be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the full armor of God, so that you will be able to resist in the evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand firm, therefore, having guided your loins with truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. In addition to all, taking up the shield of faith, with which you will be able to extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, with all prayer and petition. Pray at all times in the Spirit, and with this in view, be on the alert with all perseverance and petition for all the saints, and pray on my behalf, that utterance may be given to me in the opening of my mouth to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that in proclaiming it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. May God bless his holy word.
Amen.
We have an interesting thing this morning, which is coming just at the right time, since, as all of you will agree with me, we are all approaching the advent of the end times, in which all Christians must be on alert. We cannot afford to be in slumber anymore. The shield of victory. The shield of victory. In the Bible, Apostle Paul warned us, believer Christians, as we have just read in Ephesians 6, 10 to 12, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against the flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. You may be wondering, why we should put on the armor when I have already accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, and I believe he is sufficient for me? Our Lord did not tell us that if you follow him, you will have all the comfort and joy of this world. When our Lord was questioned by Pontius Pilate in John 18:36, Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then my servants would be fighting so that I would not be handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not of this realm." Therefore, Pilate said to him, "So you are a king?" And Jesus answered, "You say correctly that I am a king. For this I have been born, and for this I have come into the world to testify to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice."
Hallelujah.
And Pilate said to him, "What is the truth?" And when he had said this, he went out again to the Jews and said to them, "I find no guilt in him." The princes and the great men of this world are protected by soldiers, while the soldiers and policemen are protected with bulletproof coats and bulletproof helmets. The battle here we are talking about this morning are not physical battles of gunpowder, but forces more powerful and latent than gunpowder and bullets. These are invisible bullets and arrows which Satan and all his agents are equipped with to cause pain, to cause destruction, and to cause death to all children of Christ. We all know that Satan is the bitter enemy of our Lord Jesus Christ, and hence, as children and servants of our Lord, you can never be a friend of Satan, and as a result, we are under constant fear of spiritual attack.
Hallelujah.
I was having family discussion last Monday during our Monday fellowship with our sisters in Christ, where one of them hinted that the devil or Satan had no use for idle or benchwarmer Christians, but those who are serving God diligently in spirit and in truth. They are the ones that Satan will go for to derail them and to pull them down by using any form of strategy to tear them away from winning more souls for Christ. Any Christian who is playing an important part in the mission or ministry of the church is liable at times to come under spiritual attack from Satan. And those in the forefront line of Christian ministry, like the priesthood, the deaconess, the deacon, the choir and praise and worship leaders, should expect to face spiritual attack at periods in their ministry. Yet, the vast majority of Christians, and possibly also many Christian leaders, are inadequately trained in defending themselves against such attacks. Our first difficulty in handling spiritual attack is distinguishing it. Spiritual attack can be confused with both consequences of disobedience to God, to God's rule for holy living, or with a difficult period in our life as a result of our interaction with the rest of the fallen humanity, the bad people, since bad people or bad company corrupts good manners. Some people can be accused of sin and demon under every bush, while others have never been willing to admit to the possibility of the devil attacking them, if they are even prepared to admit to the reality of his existence. One lesson I have learned in this church is the foolish wisdom and attitude of some of our members and sisters, when things are tough and rough, they come close to Christ, praying with us and fellowshipping with us. And no sooner Christ hears the cries of their lamentation, they become different brothers and sisters. That God, they were searching for yesterday, is now positioned last in their consideration. While their job and regular bi-weekly pay packet becomes their golden calf image, which they are worshiping.
Amen.
We tend to forget Christ as soon as the devil starts playing on our lust, our unbelief, and faithless hearts. Yet, Satan does exist. And he wants to thwart the plans which Christ died for, to pave way for you and me in the kingdom of God.
Amen.
He is not pleased to have his territory tread, or to see leaders with vision for growing God's kingdom.
Yes.
When God's people start getting serious about being obedient to Christ Jesus, Satan is provoked.
Yes.
Although Christ has won the final victory over Satan, on the cross, we are in a period of mopping up. We are skirmishes around the hedge. We continue until the battle is completed when Jesus Christ comes again. Hallelujah.
Amen.
In particular, leaders who are committed and dedicated to the service of Christ are likely to come under spiritual oppression and attack. We have witnessed spiritual leaders and men of God going through severe spiritual attacks to the extent of near collapse of their ministry. Yet, we are not better equipped than them, except we are enjoying Christ's protection and grace, that we are all still going strong despite all our trials and tribulations in the last 8 years of our existence. Let us give glory to God.
Amen.
We thank you, Lord. We are grateful to you for seeing us through. Some have argued that once we have accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord, then we are immune from attack. However, if you are immune from attack, then we will not need passages such as Paul's teaching on the armor of Christ. How do we recognize spiritual attacks? Satan's attacks are sneaky. That's his hallmark. His trait is to capitalize on human weakness by planting doubts, by planting fear, and by planting anxiety in the hearts of Christians. He is the deceiver. His ultimate aim is to convince Christians that the security of their faith in Christ is a lie. Attacks seem to come in a number of different ways. One of them is anxiety. Satan plays on our fears in bringing us back into our minds things that are from the past and should belong in the past. I have seen many Christian believers who still, under the shadow of the darkness or the dark night, still follow their business partners and friends to occultic secret societies and places for enjoyment where all the lights are blue and hard to recognize anyone. Anytime I challenge them, the answer is that it is not what you swallow that corrupts you, but what comes out of your mouth. But I saw it differently, however, when I became full pastor of Gospel Church, and I give glory to God for that,
Amen.
For changing my life. And the second consideration is on our church life. Division in the church. Disunity in the church. Suspicion of one another's motive. And personal attacks on church leaders, on church stewards, and members are the weapons that Satan uses to disorganize the church from focusing on moving forward.
Amen.
Satan has planted few converts within the church to frustrate and discourage members who will have been useful to the church. It is very sad for me to admit that our constant wrangling and unproductive argument within the main ministry had led to the unfortunate decision of Brother Jay and his wife Amber to look for another church. It is very sad. And this is how Satan uses some of us in the church. And unless we recognize these tricks, we shall continue to wander and look for enemies outside the church when in fact we are our own enemies.
Amen.
We have many vision killers Those who are not committed enough to deliver or to have the zeal to serve God, but are ready to blackmail, to harass, to intimidate, to assassinate the good characters of the stewards trying their best to serve the Lord and discourage them. I never knew that that was also part of Satan's strategy until now, that I too am experiencing it.
Amen.
And the third one is on our own relationships. Satan loves division between Christians. We should remember that people are never the enemy. Although the attack may often come through people, and that is part of the devil's game, ultimately temptation can lead Christians into improper relationships. We read about all these instances all the time in the newspapers, on the TV, and from members of Christian community. Bishop paying secretary large sum of money to terminate his pregnancy, to cover shame, pastor's wife with children belonging to another leader in the church. And this has led to the fall of many great servants of God with disastrous results on the survival of the church. The church used to be the best places to find good marriageable partner, but not anymore. As many you find in the churches today, as